cmRNA bone is really bringing really novel, innovative, regenerative therapy solutions for specifically bone regeneration. It's really combining a lot of niche fields with respect to nanotechnology, 3D printing, cmRNA technology, and also calcium phosphates, and putting that all together to come up with a very custom, patient-specific scaffold for bone regeneration. I think that's very important because bone diseases impact hundreds of millions of people worldwide every year. And I would say that this provides a really great opportunity to society to be able to have such a technology be accessible to the public, to affect so many people, to improve their quality of life.
With the cmRNA bone project, the main objective we wanted to have is to develop a technology which we could use to help treat patients, and then have this translational technology where you could have a material delivery system which would provide cells with stimulatory molecules which then leads to new bone formation.
During my PhD project, we work on large bone defects, and you can imagine that when people have an accident and they have a bone fracture, that this normally heals quite well. But maybe if you have a large bone defect, this cannot heal by itself. And then if this doesn't heal, you end up with a non-union. So the bone doesn't bridge. And we're working on this clinical problem, and we're trying to help the bone promote this regeneration. And we're doing this by making a composite of hyaluronic acid and calcium phosphate particles. And then we combine this with this chemically modified RNA from the cmRNA bone project. And then we hope that together this induces the bone regeneration and bridges the gap of the bone.
And one of the key aspects which we were trying to think about when we were looking into this project is how can you make that clinically translatable? You need to come up with a system which could actually be used in a hospital, in a patient, and maybe sounds a little boring, but can be financially viable. And so while we're trying to be scientifically accurate, we also need to think about the real world and how healthcare systems work, patients and hospitals. How do you deliver these therapies? How do you make the cells work? How do you make the cells behave in a way you want them to behave? You need the material science aspects. So you need to have a delivery carrier system, a gel which potentially could be 3D printed. How would you develop those 3D printing technologies? We also had a partner which was developing a new 3D printer, and that 3D printer was designed purely with clinical translation in mind.
The cmRNA bone 3D bioprinter, it was developed by our consortium partners, Idoneal in Asturias in Spain. They developed them there, and then they were shipped to Switzerland, to Davos. It's like other 3D printers, but this printer specifically, so you can imagine you have a cartridge. It looks similar to a syringe. You fill it with the composite that we're making of this hyaluronic acid with calcium phosphate and maybe other materials you could use as well. And then it has a plunger at the top, and with a sort of screw that goes down, it presses on it, and then you can attach at the bottom of the syringe different needle sizes. And then while this is being pressed down, the material is being extruded. And while it's extruded, the platform underneath is moving in a specific path that we defined before. And that's how it creates then a specific structure that we would like to print. And then, of course, the printer also has a light source, so we can then cure this structure so that you can also pick it up and put it in water or cell culture medium and it stays stable.
Of course, we are talking about future. We are not talking about immediate results of the program. The program is a discovery program, and therefore is based upon developing novel technologies that may be developed into a treatment for patients. But in the long-term scenario, I think what is particularly exciting from a therapeutic point of view is that based on what we see, these hydrogels essentially, because the material produced from cmRNA bone is not hard, it's a gel-like, but it's biologically functional. So it carries within itself the right stimuli to instruct the cells of the body to actually make vessels, bone and nerves in a coordinated way, and therefore it can be very applicable because it can be shaped in any shape you want, and so it can be used to make bone in a traumatic injury. But if you have a degenerative disease where you're not actually missing a piece of bone, but the bone itself, like an osteoporosis, has less density, you can definitely imagine that this gel, like a putty, can be put inside of the thin bones and then provide the stimuli for regenerating more bone mass.
I think it's very important to see this consortium as the first one to demonstrate really the potential of this technology beyond vaccination. We know that chemically modified RNA are very potent for vaccination. We have seen that clearly as humanity during the COVID vaccine nation period. However, we are able to demonstrate that chemically modified RNA has a potential for tissue regeneration. Together with my group, before cmRNAbone, we were able indeed to conclude that these molecules were osteogenic. However, we were very focused on this process. With cmRNAbone, we have been able, with the entire consortium, to prove these molecules can induce regeneration of different tissues and different processes. Important to highlight here is indeed that it's affordable. So we have been, in the context of bone, many years investigating gene therapy by using viral delivery of plasmid DNAs. And in comparison to that, it's very attractive that messenger RNA technologies can make this affordable, which traditional gene therapy cannot. We have seen products being removed from the market just because they are not affordable for the healthcare system. And that can be a completely a game changer for messenger RNA. So we can make this technology affordable, available for all the population and the healthcare system that need to put this technology in place. It's efficient, it works, high tolerability.
So as a conception, what we're beginning to realize is we're providing data to the scientific field, which really does show a very small initial dose can have a long-term sustain effect. And then from just a general project perspective, it's often overlooked that bone is the second most transplanted biological material after blood and bone marrow. So this need for new bone substitutes is huge. And at the moment, the clinician would take some bone maybe from the hip of a patient, but you can't take all of it. It's limited. And as patients get older and more active, it's not unusual. You see 70-year-old skiers, mountain bikers. This need for bone is only going to increase. And the nice thing about the whole concept which we developed in the project is it doesn't need anything from the patient. The gel, the material, the coding sequence, the molecules is all, we can make it in the labs. And then we can hopefully produce new bone for patients, for any patient.
So I think without a doubt, we are seeing here a technology that came to stay.